Take a wild guess what relationship these people are talking about.
Kind of toxic.
No, I don't want a need.
Codependency, maybe?
Nope, not Tinder. It's coffee, the world's second most consumed beverage, and so ingrained in our lives that it's made it into paintings and all over pop culture.
I want to get some coffee. You want some coffee?
Drink a lot of coffee before I go to sleep so I can dream fast.
I always have coffee when I watch Radar, you know that.
This is, excuse me, a damn fine cup of coffee.
But your morning cappuccino might not be guaranteed. Climate change is threatening worldwide coffee crop production. Drought, rising temperatures, and irregular rainfall are ruining coffee harvests. Some studies say the amount of suitable land for coffee production could shrink by half by 2050. This bodes terribly, not just for our morning flat whites, but the 125 million people whose entire livelihoods depend on the crop.
Without investment in basic farm productivity, yeah, we're in trouble. We're in serious trouble.
As the movie Airplane warned,
are you telling us absolutely everything?
Not exactly. We're also out of coffee.
So, do we need to give up pumpkin spice latte? Yes. Or is there a way out of the future shortage?
Our story begins here, with coffee. In this beverage that has become so much a part of our lives, there is a background.
Coffee Arabica has its roots in Ethiopia. It soon spread across the Middle East and the Ottoman Empire, and finally entered Western Europe in the 17th century. In 1669, a Turkish ambassador brought coffee to the court of Louis XIV, where a coffee craze began. Cafe culture exploded on the continent, and its empires realized they could soon profit themselves from coffee trade by starting plantations in their new tropical colonies in Asia and South America. So, Portugal hauled coffee to Brazil, France to Vietnam, and Spain to Central and South America. So it's no surprise this history is still very much alive. Brazil, Vietnam, and Colombia are the top three producers of raw coffee bean. Biggest importers, the US, Germany, and France. Today, people drink over 2 billion cups of coffee worldwide every day. Consumption has almost doubled over the past three decades alone. Southeast Asia is expected to have nearly double the global growth rate, as westernizing tastes and a rising middle class increase demand. And let's not forget China. Starbucks plans to open a coffee shop every 9 hours so it can reach 9,000 locations across the country by 2025. Which means we need to be growing a lot more coffee. But climate instability is already taking a huge toll on production. In 2021, a severe frost in Brazil's coffee region of Minas Gerais wiped out coffee trees in an area roughly the size of Mauritius. Coffee prices surged nearly 13%. Regeneration of the crops and ecosystem will take years, meaning the losses will continue. Such irregular temperatures also make the plants more vulnerable to pests and disease.
For the last 15 years, a rust epidemic, coffee leaf rust, arrived in strong force across Central and South America.
This is Dr. Vern Long. She's CEO of World Coffee Research, a research nonprofit funded by the industry.
In Central America alone, 1.7 million people lost work during that period. So there are human consequences to the challenges.
El Salvador's coffee exports, once the anchor of its economy, have fallen by more than half in the last decade, triggering migration as jobs dry up. Coffee makes up over a third of Ethiopia's total export earnings, and over a quarter of its population depends on the industry for their livelihoods. Part of the difficulty is that coffee is a relatively finicky plant. It goes through a delicate flowering phase before the cherries come in, and takes 4 years for a single coffee tree to get a first harvest.
What's most difficult is that the rains were delayed.
This is Dr. Alejandra Sarmiento Soler. She's a biologist who has worked with coffee agroforestry systems in Uganda. Her daily coffee intake is 2 to 3 cups.
Then the rains come in very shorter time and are heavier, and that can affect the flowers. So the flowers can fall, or the beans have to ripen shorter time, and that also affects the quality.
Another problem is that out of the 120 or so species of coffee, we only drink 2 of them, Coffea arabica and Coffea canephora, otherwise known as Robusta. Arabica is the higher end stuff that has all those subtle flavor notes we love. As a plant, it needs the temperature between roughly 18 to 21 degrees Celsius, around 30% shade cover, with plenty of consistent rainfall. It's more sensitive to high heat, disease, and produces fewer beans. Over 60% of global production is Arabica. Its sibling, Robusta, is a more resilient plant, but tastes not as great, and ends up in mostly stuff like instant coffee. No shade to instant coffee drinkers, we see you. And that's it. We're almost entirely reliant on just 2 varietals. Coffee also has a small gene pool, and at least 60% of wild coffee species are at risk of extinction. This makes our current supply extremely vulnerable.
coffee research is so behind relative to what other commodities have. We can do so much with traditional technologies, just taking pollen from one plant, putting it on another, creating a seed of something new, collecting data at a global scale. And it's not rocket science. It's very straightforward what needs to happen.
Thankfully, there's some good news.
So there are new varieties coming up and there are some hybrids that are spread by seed.
Dr. Nerea Turreira Garcia is an ethnobotanist who's worked with hybrids in Central America and Robusta in Vietnam and Uganda.
So there is a future in that kind of variety because it's perhaps more accessible to farmers and easier to distribute.
Starbucks recently announced that it had developed 6 new varieties of coffee seeds, including hybrids, that resist leaf rust and generate higher yield in a shorter period of time. This is big news considering the chain buys about 3% of all of the world's coffee from 400,000 farmers across 30 countries. A few researchers are also trying to fish species out of the wild. Coffea stenophylla, for example, is making a splash. It's a rare and threatened species from West Africa that tolerates much warmer temperatures and actually tastes comparable to Arabica. While this varietal has commercial potential, bringing wild species into production can only exist on a niche scale and could take decades. The bigger problem is that at least 80% of the world's coffee is produced by smallholder farmers. These farmers generally work on a few hectares of land and don't have the resources to buy hybrid seedlings, which are roughly 40 to 160% more expensive than the traditional variety. More output also means more labor and carbon-intensive costs like fertilizers. Hybrids use 90% more labor and increase the cost of other inputs by almost 50%. It's an investment farmers may not have the means to take on.
That's why it's also important to have a diversified farming system and not only having coffee, but also trees or other kind of crops in order to have a safety net.
Which brings us to agroforestry. This is an approach that grows coffee alongside other plants like trees, which can increase nutrient cycling, biodiversity, carbon storage, and provide a microclimate. Some can also bring extra income from fruits, timber, or firewood. Alejandra worked with coffee farmers in Uganda who intercropped coffee plants with banana trees.
The farmers there used to say, yeah, the bananas are giving water to my coffee. It was doing it by that mechanism, still creating like a humid environment.
But it's a tricky balance. Planting other trees for shade lowers air temperature and raises soil moisture, which can protect it from weather changes and fluctuating harvests. But too much shade can hinder yield.
We should work together with the farmers in order to understand what works well for farmers, where are the synergies and where are the contradictions.
So why not just have everyone adopt agroforestry? Well, any change entails risk, which is hard for farmers to justify with just one harvest per year. It also takes extra labor and sometimes extra land to support the harvests of more than one crop. Lastly, it's about farmers' access to resources.
They don't always have access to the information that is being produced by science. We need to combine traditional ecological knowledge or agroecological knowledge together with the scientific knowledge.
Without the support, there's a big disincentive for coffee farmers who often prefer to stick with what they know. Given how hard it is to adapt in our current conditions, the future of coffee could look a little more different than we think. As in, your coffee could come from some unexpected places. Experts say that countries like China and Australia have ramped up coffee bean production in recent years and could become bigger players in the future. But for now, our coffee addictions aren't going anywhere anytime soon, and the industry's strategy to keep up its pipeline is
technology, technology, technology. We are really focused on the technology, you know, needs. I would say in the next 5 to 10 years, we'll see a flush of new varieties. It's a paintbrush and a, you know, spreadsheet. Very, very intensive data analysis. That's what we do.
This takes the cross-disciplinary work of scientists, governments, and everyone in the supply chain. But as consumers, the best we can do is pay attention to sourcing. The coffee supply chain often lacks transparency as it's bad for business. So what we can do is work with smaller suppliers who give more information on the origins and production conditions of their coffee beans. As Walter Sobchak says in The Big Lebowski,
I'm staying. I'm finishing my coffee.
So what's your relationship to coffee like? Let us know in the comments below, and don't forget to hit like and subscribe. See you next time.